QC practice number three, know the number of results between QC evaluations. Know the number of patient results between QC evaluations. Now, when we talk about QC frequency in the laboratory, we tend to talk about it in terms of time. Have to run at least two levels of control once a day. We run QC once a shift. It's perfectly acceptable to talk about quality control testing, quality scheduling quality control in terms of time. It's a natural way for us to think about it. It fits naturally into laboratory workflow. But from the patient's perspective, risk is related to the number of patient results examined between QC evaluations, not the length of time between QC evaluations. What do I mean by that? Let's assume there are two laboratories. Both laboratories test QCs once a day, once every 24 hours. And in both laboratories, an out of control condition occurs somewhere in the middle of the day, adversely affecting patient results. And if any of you have seen any of my presentations or papers in the recent past, this cartoon I use frequently, the little red asterisks are meant to denote patient results that fail to meet their quality requirement. In these two situations, the interval between QC testing is the same, 24 hours, but in the lower cartoon, many, many more patients are tested between QCs, between QC events. The percent of red asterisks in the two cases is the same, but there are many, many more red asterisks in the bottom cartoon than in the upper cartoon because there were many more patients tested between QC events. So the patient risk isn't related to the 24 hours. It's related to the number of patients that were tested between those two QC events. So go ahead and schedule by time, but be aware of the average number of analyte examinations you're doing between QC events. And it's going to differ for every analyte, right? But you need to be aware because risk, from the patient's perspective, is going to be related to the number of analytes tested between QC events. Number of analyte examinations. QC practice number four. Estimate the magnitude of an out of control condition before correcting it. Now when you get a QC rule rejection, when you detect an out of control condition, the first thing you should do is estimate the magnitude of that out of control condition. Now, why am I saying that? I should point out that the first three practices that I've just gone over are really related directly to patient risk, trying to mitigate patient risk. This practice is really more about trying to minimize cost of rework, unnecessary rework in the laboratory, cost of poor quality, okay? So the first three were kind of focused on the patient. This one's more focused on the laboratory. So why do I say first estimate the magnitude of the failure? First note that the QC results that triggered the QC rule rejection provide very little information regarding the magnitude of the out of control condition. It's just results to really give you a good sense for what the magnitude of the out of control condition is. And I would claim it's a good investment to try to do a better job when that out of control condition is detected of assessing its magnitude. There are many ways you can do that. I'm not going to get into how you might do that. An obvious easy way would be to run additional replicates of quality control material and take the mean difference between what you're getting in the replicates and the target value. Once you've estimated the magnitude, then go ahead and identify the cause and correct the failure. But now because you've estimated the magnitude of that out of control condition, the way that you approach recovery from that out of control condition is better informed, and you should be able to do a more cost-effective recovery. So let me try to give a little cartoon example of that. Two situations here. We end up in both cases with a QC rule rejection. In the upper cartoon, it's meant to denote a fairly small magnitude out of control condition. If we know, if we spend a little bit of resources to be able to identify that it's a fairly small out of control condition, there are a couple of things then that we know. First of all, we know that because it's a small out of control condition, it's less likely that a lot of patient results would fail to meet their quality requirement, denoted here by not so many red asterisks. The other thing that we would know is that if it's not a very large out of control condition, there's a good chance we didn't detect it the first scheduled QC after it occurred. It's probably occurred for a while. Conversely, if when we get our QC rule rejection and we estimate the magnitude of the out of control condition, we find that it seems to be a fairly large out of control condition, then we have to acknowledge that probably there's quite a high frequency of the results that we've just produced and reported that have failed to meet the quality requirement. But we also probably can expect there's a good chance we detected this out of control condition the first try. Now, in the absence of knowing whether I'm in that first case or the second case, I can only take a single approach to my recovery, right? Whatever your approach might be. But with that kind of knowledge, the way I would approach recovery in the lower cartoon would be different than it would be in the upper cartoon. I'd be more concerned about really getting at those results that I've just been producing prior to the QC rule rejection and trying to identify and correct results, because I expect there are probably quite a few bad ones. In the upper panel, I might decide, you know, my assessment is that there are so few bad results, I'm going to be doing a lot of retesting and find very few incorrect results. Maybe I'll be more selective in terms of the ones that I'll try to identify and correct. Maybe I'll just look for the results that were close to a medical decision limit or that maybe had an unusually large delta check, and I'll just focus on those and none of the others. And again, I'm not going to go into what the kind of strategy might be, but I would say that if you invest a little bit in doing a better job of estimating the magnitude of the out of control condition before you correct it, you can probably more than make up those extra resources in terms of doing a much more cost-effective recovery. It also has the added benefit of you build up a database of knowledge about what kinds of out of control conditions have occurred in the past.